So our first presenters in this part of the program are Alice Sylvester and Jim Spaeth of Sequent Partners. They're going to provide highlights of the study that they just completed for CIMM and the 4As on current practices, areas for innovation in cross-channel attribution and ROI analysis. So Alice and Jim.
Wow.
It's a great time to be in media analytics. It really is. It's one of the most dynamic time periods that we have seen in a really long time. And I'm going to tell you the findings from our study that we just executed. And we wanted to thank Jane and thank Terry and the 4As to let us have this opportunity to look into the current practices in ROI measurement and attribution. We're covering off Jane's section on evaluation and, you know, understanding what's working and how do you make that work more often and more better, is really what's on the minds of marketers all over the country. So this study we started with deep qualitative immersion among agency modelers and marketers. And then we executed an RFI where we asked all the providers, not all, but as many providers as we could find in this field to answer questions about what are you doing, how do you do it, and what does it look like? 21 companies answered our RFI on this. So we have a very solid base of insights about what's happening. And what seems to be happening is that we now are on the brink of being able to finally bridge two separate measures of ROI and evaluation. A market mix model that we have historically been talking about, it's been around for 30 years, provides a great high-level strategic insights for marketers. It goes across the entire marketing mix, not just advertising. It's sort of been the bane of some people's existence. It's tricky. It doesn't deal with a lot of the executional issues that people in media spend a lot of time on. It doesn't take into account creative. The data feeds are kind of messy, but we have lived with this master for a number of years. But the new game in town is all about attribution. It's coming out of the digital field, and it involves simply attributing an outcome to some exposure event that occurred in this chain. Attribution is going to provide quick and granular tactical guidance. So for the first opportunity, we have to see the big, broad macro picture and then get very, very micro with attribution. Both of them have their strengths, and both of them will provide a very interesting next generation for us. The thing about a bridge is it has no affinity to either side, and when it comes together, it provides a great deal of utility. We are building a bridge of epic proportion. This is language we picked up in the presentation. What's happening here is we are looking for the currency of impact. Regardless of everything that Reno just said, if you get to the point where you can evaluate how many people are buying or looking or doing what you want them to do because of an individual ad, that's where we want to be. And that's always been the promise in this business. It's been elusive. And we are building one hell of a bridge. We're going to link attribution results right straight through to DMPs, to buying and selling. So finally, people are talking about sort of real-time or near real-time optimization. We could be on the brink of going from measuring ROI, evaluating it after it happens, to managing it going forward in a much more dynamic way. When you look into making a presentation on bridges, you learn some interesting things about how bridges are designed and all the elements that have to go into it. And it's quite a science, as you might imagine. You have to think about, what is this bridge doing? Are people going to walk on it? Are we just driving on it? How many lanes should be in? What's the groundwork that has to be laid to make my bridge? What is the nature around here that I have to take into consideration? And aesthetically, what is this bridge going to look like? All of these things, and all of these things are being examined in our industry right now. We are about 2 years into what marketers say is a 5-year journey. you know, or it's the first inning. Any one of those metaphors you might want to use. It's early. It is a little bit of the Wild West, but that's so negative. When in fact, the optimism and the excitement about this promise of being able to seamlessly evaluate what's happening to consumers and being able to make mid-flight optimizations is really powerful. But because we are where we are right now, we have a lot of work to do in terms of getting our bridge correct. So we are going to deal with building materials. We need disaggregated media data. We need on and offline data. And as I said, digital attribution was driving this because it's such a closed ecosystem, but marketers want to move beyond digital and apply those principles to a whole series of disaggregated data in other media like television. So we need disaggregated data. We need identity matching. We need device matching. In terms of the support for these bridges, we need the rest of the marketing mix. A lot of times that's left out. So if you're only looking at what digital is doing, you're going to think digital is doing it all, when in fact digital is only doing a part of it. For the design, we have to have the right model, and it has to be validated to put these things together to reflect the entire way the ecosystem works. And the utility of our bridge, in order to use it, we have to figure out what the organizational processes are that are going to make this information come through and let people act on it right away. What happens next? Oh. Optimism is amazing and really important right now, because if you really talk to people, the conversation goes south fairly fast. There's a lot of stresses on this infinitely complex ROI bridge. Some of them are the incomplete data streams that we have. It's possible we could have used an image of those bridges to nowhere, you know, the ones that got built where you thought you were going somewhere, and then you're like, oh, wow, we're not going there. But there are a lot of things that have to be addressed. Innovative but untested techniques. We uncovered 26 different types of modeling techniques that are being used right now to evaluate the relationship between exposure and outcomes. There's a lack of transparency. One of the people in our survey said the transparency runs the gamut from a white box to a black box. And that's not good. That doesn't make people feel really good about what's going on and help us improve the practice. There are significant knowledge gaps. In fact, it's awesome that one of the reasons we did this study was to put something in the marketplace so people could rely on it and take a look at it. What are the definitions? What questions should we ask when we're buying an attribution product? We also have organizational beliefs and adoptions and silos. How do you manage some and cross-platform optimization when you don't have a cross-platform company, when the two sides aren't ever talking to each other? How do you make all of this work? We have people issues, we have business issues, and we have technology issues in moving forward here. But as I said, it's an amazing bridge. The industry right now is going along two different paths. One, where we see the integration of market mix models and digital attribution as one whole path. About half the people who answered our RFI provide that solution. So they do a big top, high level, all the elements of the marketing mix, and they assign value to each one of those and say, how much did it contribute to sales? And then they do digital attribution, and they are allowed to see what was the consumer journey through the website and the display ads and social to the extent that they can with the walled gardens. So they use market mix models to sort of constrain the amount of input or the amount of effect that digital can have. So it's an integrated system that brings both of these together. On the other hand, people are also building cross-platform attribution where they're bringing in television, they're bringing in subscriber data from magazines, they're bringing in the digital radio data, all at an individual, very granular level. It's less common, but it certainly is the future. So some of the issues associated with the first approach that's really very prevalent in our industry right now. Market mix models are
awesome. We've had a lot of experience with them. The CFO relies on them. People really like them. But they're not perfect. And this system assumes they're right. So we've always talked about more granular media data, more granular geographic data, more frequent modeling updates. A lot of times these are end of the year reviews, getting ready for next year's spend. And interestingly enough, you have to have experience with the medium in order for it to be in the model. So it doesn't allow for, to do what ifs unless you go into the market and test it. So there's some work to be done on market mix models and feeding more granular data there. Another issue that we have with this particular approach is when you get it to the other side, so if we're using market mix models to set the big levels on what the contribution is of all these media, and then you want to see what happens on the individual tactics for digital, you need some pretty clean data. We need complete, unbiased data at the persons and the household level. We need the linkage to offline outcomes, and we need nationally representative data. A whole lot easier said than done. Every one of these areas is complicated, and we have pockets of greatness. We don't have the full picture. And finally, putting these two systems together, market mix model at the big level and digital attribution much further down into the tactical, we don't know what those systems, whether you can put those things together very well. The techniques and the algorithms for linking all of this has not been validated, has not been tested. It's like, okay, we link them together somehow. But you know what's at stake is, did this campaign in this medium or in this tactic work? And it's the one place where you take exception to the good, you know, don't let good be the enemy of what? Great progress? What is it? Sorry. You know what I'm trying to say? You know where people say it's good enough? Here, it may not be good enough. So that's what we're wrestling with. Jim is going to take you through the other work that's being done in the industry.
Great. Thank you, Alice. I want to be careful about our tone here. All right. So I want to just take a moment and be careful about this. Because it's sort of like, you ever have a friend come up to you at an event like this, and you just got up and gave a great presentation? I mean, this might be great, hopefully. But you just gave a great presentation, you're feeling so good about yourself, and you step out, you're at the reception, and your friend says, you know, I'm a really good friend of yours. And only your best friend would tell you this. But for the past hour, your fly's been open. So, you know, so we're going to be a best friend when it comes to attribution, because we love the image, we love the vision, we love where it's going. The ability to actually change and improve marketing and advertising ROI is just tremendous. So we're going to talk a bit about where the outages are and where there's a need for opportunity for improvement and so on. We're not trying to be negative in that way. So I just want to be really, really clear about that as we attempt to operate. Oh, I hit the right button and it works. Okay, there we go. All right, it's a learning curve, right? So when we think about the cross-channel attribution bridge, just purely working at an attribution level, which in our world, our definition is we're saying that's a household, a device, an individual, a consumer level, not a market level. There are a number of different techniques which may or may not be normally known as attribution that fit into that bucket, but that's kind of what differentiates its level of granularity and the timing that make a difference. And there's a theme I'm going to harp on here a bit, and it's completeness. Because completeness is important, because if you haven't measured everything in the mix, then you have the opportunity for misattribution. And then there's going to be accuracy and representativity, because otherwise you can have bias in the results. Now, I'll speak to that in a few moments, but those are issues that we have to look at in terms of primarily the data sources. You know, there are issues around the modeling techniques as well, but you know, we need complete, unbiased, precise data at the persons or the household level. That's the definition that we're working with here. So when you think about accurate, representative data, another key element is validation. So Alice talked about the modeling techniques, and there's a lot of, hey, it must be right, it came out of a computer. Well, okay, right. But there are so many techniques, as Alice referenced, that we really have to understand which techniques are good for which purposes. The one thing the point I wanted to make is, you know, we could be looking at individual data sources for individual media, and we can say, yep, this data source is great, it's really complete, it's representative, it's highly validated, it's MRC accredited, it's perfect, but we're gonna take this data source and this data source, now we're gonna match them together. Well, you know, you have the same question again, because the matches aren't complete. So you have to ask yourself, what results from the match, you know, is that now still complete and accurate and representative? Or is there an opportunity for misattribution? And is there an opportunity for bias? And the reason we harp on those two themes are simple. Let me give you an example. We were looking at a case study recently where it really looked like display was carrying all the weight. It was really driving the ROI and the success of the campaign. So the advertiser decided to cut their television spending. 6 months later, they realized, wait a minute, display's not working as well because the media work together. So when things are, now that's a case where you measured the whole picture and you could understand that the mistake could be identified and rectified, but if you didn't do that, you just wouldn't even understand what's going on. There's a chance to misattribute and give credit to the wrong medium and move money inappropriately. So, these go a little slow. This is hardly even worth talking about, right? So everyone in this room understands that when we start talking about how complete, how representative the data is, when we think about the data that goes into attribution, big data in every case, there are questions that we can ask ourselves about each one of them. Again, is it complete? Is it representative? Does it really represent the world as we see it and as we know it to be? Now, I think again, tone is really important here. We're raising all of these questions, but the key issue isn't to say, okay, these techniques are wrong. They're incomplete. Doesn't measure the whole country. It's wrong. The question is it right enough? Is it right for me? So, for example, if you were a major nationally distributed brand and you have a sort of a scattered set of data, your distribution may be so uniform across the country, it really doesn't matter. On the other hand, if you had a regional brand that was really, really doing well in Southern California, and the data you had happened to either not have Southern California or was all Southern California, you're gonna get a very, very wrong picture of the impact of your marketing. So it's really critical that the data is suitable for your business. That's one of our key messages, isn't that this is right and this is wrong, do this, don't do that. It's more ask a lot of questions, demand transparency, and then understand if it works for your business. So you know that applies to things like the device graphs, the device matching. Does the resulting data reflect my business? You know, can I take a digital data stream and impute traditional media exposure onto it and get a result that's representative of my business? That's the critical thing. I mean, we used to live in a world where you could say, okay, the data has been MRC accredited, it's great, we trust it, it's good for everything. We don't live in that world anymore. You have to take more responsibility, look at the data, and decide if it works for your brand, for your case, for your, you know, for your situation. And so when we say complete, so this kind of comes to the issue of the concern about misattribution. What's complete? So if you think about a process of building out, so attribution began in the digital world. And it was interesting to us because as we began this study, we completely misunderstood the term multi-touch attribution. In our minds, multi-touch meant, okay, it's all the consumer touch points. No, in general usage, multi-touch means all the digital touch points. So we're trying to help, in the paper you'll see, we try to clarify digital attribution, multi-touch attribution, cross-channel attribution, television attribution, they all refer to different things. But, so if you think about this in terms of building it out from digital attribution, you get your arms around all the impact, all the different digital factors, digital media, that's great. But you know, as I said earlier, what if television had a role here? What if promotion had a role here? What if we ran a really important one-week paid search campaign and business was off the charts? Oh yeah, we dropped our price that week as well. So you have to be able to look at that. So it's important to pull in all the factors that impact consumer behavior, starting with the consumer, starting with the fact that a lot of sales would have occurred with no marketing whatsoever. So in the marketing mix modeling world, we know this is the baseline. There's a certain momentum to big, particularly big brands, well-established brands, businesses are just gonna go on and on, not indefinitely, but for some time. And if you don't take that into account, you're not correctly measuring the incrementality of any of the parts of the marketing plan. So you need to understand the consumer, what might have happened otherwise. In the absence of marketing, you need to understand all the other marketing factors going on. How about environmental factors? How about the weather? You know, I mean, how about the weather? But anyway, but how about the weather? You know, what if suddenly sales for my new movie, attendance for my new movie is way down. What happened? Oh my God, the media aren't working. Oh wait, there was a huge snowstorm. No one left their house that day. So, you know, we live in the real world, not just the digital world. And that needs to all come together. One other point I would say is we have a long history of understanding how consumers respond to advertising. There's lots of research, lots of science of all sorts that have gone into this. We know things like advertising has a lingering effect. You know, we call it ad stock, but if you don't know the term ad stock, it just means, you know, the advertising that was delivered today continues to have an impact down the road, days, weeks, months later in many, many cases. We know that advertising has a diminishing returns effect because, you know, reach builds to 100. And once you get to 100, it starts to bend, or maybe it doesn't even get to 100 and starts to bend. There are long-term effects of advertising. And this is one thing we hammer at a fair amount because it's often overlooked. There's such an emphasis on short-term outcomes that it's important to really stop and realize a lot of that advertising builds brand. Builds brands. What did Reno say a few minutes ago? We talked about, in his view, television is still the most effective medium for building brands, drives awareness. Well, awareness, sales happen later. But once you've created awareness, once you've built a preference consideration for the brand, it's fertile territory for the other parts of the marketing plan to harvest that opportunity. So, you know, looking at the long term is critically important and doesn't happen often enough. But there are a lot of things we understand about how consumers respond to advertising that needs to be reflected in the model. We're not going to say this set of statistics is right and that set of statistics is wrong, but the statistics have to reflect what we know about how consumers respond to advertising. Otherwise, I think we'd say it is wrong. It just doesn't match the world as we know it. So, Alice alluded to this. The big promise, the big opportunity here is that attribution models operate at a level of granularity and a tempo that fits the decisions we have to make in the marketplace. Instead of being a report card that we read a year later, it enables us to understand what's happening in the moment, to make changes, to feed directly into ad tech, directly into the buying processes, directly into the whole decision-making process, which is where value is created. And that's really critical and something we can't lose sight of. I'm not sure those connections are as clean and as effective as they could be. I think we've seen in some cases they can be. Strangely enough, one of the biggest hurdles isn't data, it isn't the analytics, it's organizational structure. You know, we can have cross-platform measurement, we can have cross-platform analytics and modeling, but we don't have too many cross-platform organizations. Not when digital is bought in one agency, television is bought in another, print maybe in another. How do you coordinate those? You know, I'd love to be the guy who says, you know, we should who's talking to the digital agency, says, I think we should shift some money out of display and put it into television. And the digital agency is saying, you mean you want to take the money from my pocket and put it in his pocket? That doesn't go down so well. So there are huge organizational issues that need to be looked at as well. Data, analytics, organization, you know, they're all very, very important. So how do we make progress? How do we construct this bridge? We think there's a lot of work to be done. We think, starting with even the people in this room, it's entirely possible. It's within our grasp. It's, you know, it's a few years, but it's entirely capable. We need to assess data accuracy and completeness. We need to establish some common language, some common definitions. We need to formalize standards. We need to drive innovation. And how might we do that? We think, just to try to bring some organization to this list of tasks, there might be four working groups. So the first thing, because it's right there, it's right on our plate, is complete digital attribution. There are cost issues. I don't mean what it costs, but I mean issues about how you allocate costs within the attribution model. You know, I spent this much on the buy. Well, what did this unit cost? What did that unit cost? Sometimes it's not so clear. We need to link to offline outcomes. A lot of that has happened. How has it happened? How well has it happened? Is it right? Can we be transparent about how it happens? Can we validate the outcomes? We need to link to those brand baselines, the sales that would have happened anyway, so that we're getting true incrementality. We need to look at the offline driver. So there's some work there to get digital attribution to operate with a more complete picture. We need to then move cross-platform, pulling television in, other media in, bring in the brand metrics. And again, some of that is happening now. Some of it's happening well. Some of it's happening not so well. And it calls for transparency, openness, understanding across the industry. We need to make the attribution process itself transparent. It's the technology makes my head spin, and I've been functioning in this world for a long time. It's amazing to me that some of the techniques being used came out of academia 4 or 5 years ago. That's really new. So we need to understand it. We need to express it in ways that everyone here can understand and make intelligent decisions about it. And finally, we need smarter users. We need training programs. We need to do some benchmarking. There are those organizational issues. So there's a whole set of issues, different types of issues, but we're capable. We can do it. I know everyone in this room is capable of joining in some way and making these things happen because we think it's important. The vision is really great. And it's interesting, again, to hear Reno talking about stepping up and having Group M, the buyer side, the user side, saying, wait, we're going to tell you what we need. So you need to consult with the industry. You need to get the resolution from the industry. And we firmly believe you need to have MRC audits. We need to know what's under the hood. And that's a lot at the level of detail these things operate for any of us to be completely expert in every single component. We really, really need that. We have an industry function. We have an industry structure. We should use it. So finally, I want to say that these bridges weren't built in a day. The Brooklyn Bridge took 13 years and many lives were lost. Golden Gate Bridge took 4 years. The Tappan Zee Bridge is still happening up there. I don't think we're going to lose any lives in this industry, although you never know. But the ROI bridge is on pace. It's not happened. It hasn't quite happened yet. It is happening. We think we're going to see it. We think the goals are important and worth every bit of effort that it would take. And in fact, some days we even say, okay, that's really great, we can see the vision, but is this bridge even big enough? Marketing is about 10% of company spend. What about the other 90%? What about the other things they invest in? Shouldn't that be part of the kind of the analytics world? Shouldn't we bring that under the same kind of analytics control to make the best business investments? But that's a topic for another day. So I'm gonna ask my partner to come up, and we have a few minutes we can take your questions, your comments, your rebuttals, and I hope you read the white paper. There's thank you. This is just some highlights, and we really would recommend you read the white paper and let us know what you think, and agree, disagree, we're totally open to it.
Question in the back. Yeah.
David.
With a microphone, that could be dangerous, so I'll speak quietly. I started reading the paper this morning on the train, 22 pages, so it's going to take me a little while, but thank you.
22 well-crafted pages.
Excellently crafted pages, content-rich. One of the things that has dogged this industry with attribution has been a desire to solve it, and I love the way you talked about it being a process. If you had to think of this as, say, I don't know, football field, and we're at the 20-yard line, or maybe in your 2 to 5 years, we're at the 45-yard line. What does the next down or two look like? What does the next first down or two look like, in your opinion?
I'll answer. Fix digital attribution, because that's where the money is right now. It's how people are evaluating the impact of digital. But there's some holes in it right now. Remember, the promise is to look at the entire consumer journey. Well, it's difficult when you can't see into Facebook or YouTube. So there are so many challenges right in front of us on the tools that are being used already all over the place.
Yeah, and I would add to that, there's been tremendous progress made. honestly, we kind of became aware of digital attribution about 2 years ago. And without naming names and pointing fingers, I'll say some of the techniques that were in use were laughable. And I'm usually more diplomatic than that, but they were laughable. When we did our project, and I'll embarrass Michael, because Convertro submitted their RFI, and others too, so I'm not going to single them out as the only good company. I was blown away at the introduction of science and statistics, analytics, good data hygiene, and various things that had come into play within the last 2 years.
Yeah, it's really cool. People are using game theory. People are using artificial intelligence. It's going to be solved at a big technical level. So it's very cool. Come on, we have 3 minutes left. What's the biggest surprise you saw in the whole presentation, Jim?
Well, that it's achievable, that we can do it. That didn't surprise me at all. But I think that's the most important thing. There's work to be done, and we're capable of doing it. We have the talent, as I said, right here in this room.
You know what? I thought the prevalence of it was a bit of a surprise. I thought it would be more pocketed in certain areas of the industry, certain categories. Question?
Wow, this is actually really loud. It's not just him. I have a background in doing all sorts of attribution modeling. I've recently moved away from that, but in evaluating a lot of those partners and vendors and working at agencies that were putting huge amounts of statistical rigor behind gathering the data and ensuring that the models and the approaches we used were appropriate for the clients and the business that we were working on, I kind of get the sense in the industry right now that there's an expectation that there will be a one-size-fits-all, you know, a machine learning, an ensemble model, or, you know, something deep learning or something that will solve the problem for everybody universally. And I'm not seeing a lot of recognition for the fact that different industries and different businesses have different needs, different goals, and may therefore require a broader array of techniques. Do you have any sort of insight into what you saw kind of across business needs and, you know, what techniques are popping up in which particular verticals?
Well, first, yes, we would totally agree. I don't think in this study we really looked at, for example, the needs of different industries. We've done that at different times, and we know different industries work on different metrics. Different industries have different complexity to their marketing plans and require more complexity or less complexity in their modeling. There's always a trade-off between, you know, how complete and sophisticated the modeling is versus how quickly you can get results out. And, you know, speed to insight or speed to decision is really, really critical, because the right answer, the perfect answer a week after the media ran isn't terribly useful. So there's a trade-off there, and I think it's really, I said this earlier, you know, we've come out of a world where there was a single big, you know, audited measurement service in every medium, and it was pretty much right for everything for everybody all the time, and now it's really more their fit for purpose. What works for my brand, not even by industry, I mean, there's a distinction by industry, but, you know, my brand's gonna be a little bit different, and will this work for my brand or not? So, you know, that's kind of the ugly truth, and maybe that's my answer to your question, Alice. The ugly truth inside of all of this is that we have to look deeper, we have to understand better. We can't just say, oh, it's okay, you know, it's not to pick on them, but one of my favorite quotes was, I don't know, the data must be fine, I get it from Experian.
Unfortunately, we have to go.
All right, thank you all. We'll be around.
Thanks for having us.